Sunday. At the time of this recording, it is actually Saturday around 10:30 a.m. We are pre-recording the service today because we're expecting snow later tonight. We want you all to stay home and stay safe, but still join together and worship God. So thank you for joining us online today. Announcements. Saturday, January 13th is going to be our next free community dinner. We will be serving roast pork. Jumping ahead to February, February 11th will be the Super Bowl of Caring. Financial donations will go to the Seven Loaves Soup Kitchen and Tuncanic, and any canned goods that you bring in will go to the lower Wyoming County Food Pantry. And then jumping even further ahead, we're scheduling another fun movie night on February 23rd. We will be showing The Ultimate Gift. If you're interested in going to the Sight and Sound trip to see Daniel on May 14th, there's flyers in the back of the church you can pick up when you're here next. It's $180, and that pays for dinner and the ride down and the tickets to see the show. You don't have to give it to me, actually. You can just mail it to the address that's on the paper there. There are still slots available. Donna and I are going, so you'll be in good company if you decide to join us. Lastly, because it's a new year, if you need church envelopes to make your offering payments, please, for the purpose of tax statements, please see Robert Phillips. What's next? Please join me for the call to worship. Oh, prayer. I have to pray first. I think that's a very good idea. Dear Father, thank you for just all the gifts that we're surrounded with today. Not just the glorious changing of the weather to which winter snow is a part of, but the gift to be able to pre-record our services and keep everyone warm and safe. Please watch over Mark and Aaron and I today as we deliver this service in preparation for Sunday tomorrow. Me especially, let my words be the words that you want people to hear. We love you. Amen. Please join me for the call to worship. In the beginning, God created all things.
And God saw that they were good.
And at our beginning, God created us.
Unique and irreplaceable, loved and wanted by God, known and treasured by God even before he created us.
In all our beginnings, God creates something new.
So we will seek God in the freshness of this morning, in the laughter of friends, in the colors of creation, and in this beautiful place.
Lord God, King of creation,
open our eyes to see your presence, our souls to sense your presence, and our hearts to love your presence, even here in your creation and ever beyond it in eternity. Amen.
Amen. Please join me in the opening prayer, which comes from the Methodist Book of Daily Prayer, and it was written by Matt. Someone. I can't pronounce that last name. Join me. God of new birth and life, second chances and new beginnings, on the cusp of ending one year and the beginning of another, I invite you to continue your work of making me new. As I enter a new year, I pray for that which I need to leave behind in order to embrace something new,
for big decisions that I need to make,
for areas in my life where I hope for new opportunities, for habits that I hope to prioritize, for areas of my faith that I want to grow in, as you make all things new. I pray that your Holy Spirit would work in me to reshape me, that I may live a new way for you this year. Amen. I will just apologize in advance. I've had a cold for like a month. I'm going to sing my best today, and you join me at home because there's nobody there to hear you. If you were in church, but I'm just going to give you a summary of the joys and concerns that have come over the prayer chain that we share online. And if you are not yet part of that, you know, you can email Darcy and be added to it. So earlier this week, we have a great praise told to us by Penny about Faith Jones, who has come through a surgery today, and she can now walk on her way and begin physical therapy. So, you know, I mean, there's still a lot of healing to go there, but what a great success, and she is well on her way. So praise and then continued prayers for continued healing. Darcy's dad, Bill Beebe, and his mission team are heading to their annual mission trip to Louisiana. They left 2 days ago, and so the prayer chain asked for us to have safe travels. And then an unwelcome addition to that, yesterday, because there always seems to be bad weather when they go on this mission trip every year. They got in a car accident. They were part of a multi-car pileup. The vehicle that had Darcy's dad and other people in it was totaled. They're all okay, and they were able to rent a vehicle and are now back on their own road. I talked to Darcy this morning. They made it to Alabama as of, 10:30 Saturday morning, and they hope to be at their destination by the end of the night tonight. So hopefully by the time you get this message, they will be in Louisiana, and that's when the actual work begins. So just keep that whole mission trip in your prayers all week long, please. Penny sent in to pray for those who have to work outside in this inclement weather. We get to stay home and watch church online, but other people have to go to work and travel for a variety of reasons, and some people are homeless and they don't have the warm shelter to hide in, so just please, God, comfort them. Keep in your prayers from our prayer chain Leo with leukemia, Carl Carpenter for continued healing, a baby boy who's in the pediatric ICU who's close to someone in our church family, Sharon, who's struggling with her hip rehab, Mary Addington, who's Carol's cousin, who's in the hospital, David, as he recovers from significant tooth surgery that he had past Wednesday. My brother Joe is in rehab, so please keep him in your prayers. Probably be there for another month, and hopefully it's what he needs to get things going. Keep people struggling as we start a new year, and just help people be on the right path, and prayers for a blessed new year for everyone. Joy for the birth of Vivian Elise Belcher to David and Victoria. Nadia got her driver's license. I guess she gets to drive in the snow now. And I know it's always easy to forget this one, but every week in your bulletin at the bottom of that little bookmark that Darcy makes, there's the list of the Circle of Prayer churches, and it's easy to forget them. I don't know a lot of the churches on this list, but God does, and if they're like us, they're a bunch of well-meaning people trying to do God's work in difficult times, and they need our prayer, so continue to pray for them. Anything to add here? All right, so let us sing as we center our minds and hearts for prayer towards God. Just thank you for all the gifts that you bring with us here, the joys that we can celebrate in our lives, new births, successes, answered prayers. You are just full of all these gifts. Help us to remember those in the dark times. Help us to remember those who are not as privileged as we are, the homeless and people outside working in cold, snowy days, the people that are still in need of healing and change. Please just watch over them. We know that our prayer adds to the power of their recovery, and so help us be conscientious stewards of your prayer. Please watch over the churches of Hickorytown, Snowshoe, Vera, First, Trinity Calvary, Bell Memorial, Nalja, Christ Community, Yorkshire, East Lemon, and help them find their path to be closer to you. We say all these things in your name with the prayer you taught us to pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Should we just skip this part? We're just going to skip over the offering in traditional fashion. You know, the mailing address is there on the screen, so if you want to mail in your offering for this week, or if you're planning on being here physically next week, you can give it to us then. Remember that the money that the church receives goes to, you know, pay for the salaries of the people that work here and maintain the building and all of the, like, missions and projects that we do. If you ever want your money to go towards a specific mission or project, you know, just note that somehow when you give it to us. Please join us in the next song. Genesis, so the first chapter of Genesis, not the whole thing, but, you know, the bulk of it. And the version that I chose to share with you today is the version written by Robert Alter, who's an Old Testament scholar and language expert. And the version that he has, one of the things that he said he took into consideration when he was writing it was that he wanted to preserve the literary qualities of the original Bible, because sometimes in translation, the poetry of the thing gets lost, and so it's one of the things that I appreciate about it. And I also think that with a passage that's super familiar to you, like the opening of Genesis, it's sometimes very helpful to hear a version that's different than what you're used to hearing, because it makes you pay attention to it more, because it feels fresh and new to you. So here we go. Genesis chapter 1, verses 1 through 25. When God began to create heaven and earth, and the earth then was welter and waste, and darkness over the deep, and God's breath hovering over the waters, God said, "Let there be light," and there was light. And God saw the light, and that it was good, and God divided the light from the darkness. And God called the light day, and the darkness he called night. And it was evening, and it was morning, first day. And God said, "Let there be a vault in the midst of the waters, and let it divide water from water." And God made the vault, and it divided the water beneath the vault from the water above the vault. And so it was. And God called the vault heavens, and it was evening, and it was morning. second day. And God said, let the waters under the heaven be gathered in one place so that dry land will appear. And so it was. And God called the dry land earth, and the gathering of the waters he called seas. And God saw that it was good. And God said, let the earth grow grass, plants yielding seed of each kind, and the trees bearing the fruit of each kind that has its seed within it upon the earth. And so it was. And the earth put forth grass, plants yielding seed, trees bearing fruit of each kind. And God saw that it was good. And it was evening, and it was morning, third day. And God said, let there be lights in the vault of heaven to divide the day from the night. And they shall be signs for the fixed times and for the days and for the years. And they shall be lights in the vault of heavens to light up the earth. And so it was. And God made two great lights upon the earth. The great light for dominion of the day, and the small light for dominion of the night, and the stars. And God placed them in the vault of the heavens to light up the earth, and to have dominion over day and night, and divide the light from the darkness. And God saw that it was good. And it was evening, and it was morning, fourth day. And God said, let the waters swarm over the swarm of living creatures, and let the fowl fly over the earth across the vault of heavens. And God created the great sea monsters and every living creature that crawls, which the water had swarmed forth of each kind, and the winged fowl of each kind. And God saw that it was good. And blessed them, saying, be fruitful and multiply and fill the water and the seas, and let the fowl multiply in the earth. And it was evening, and it was morning, fifth day. And God said, let the earth bring forth living creatures of each kind, cattle and crawling things and wild beasts of each kind. And so it was. And God made wild beasts of each kind, and cattle of every kind, and all crawling things on the ground of each kind. And God saw that it was good. The word of God for all people. Thanks be to God. In the beginning, the world was a state of nothingness, which was called chaos. Then, suddenly, from the nothingness came light, and then came Gaia, Mother Earth, and from her came Uranus, the sky, along with the other primordial gods. And Gaia proceeded to give birth and populate her body with creatures, creating monsters and all kinds of powerful gods, which could be argued are a different kind of monster. But wait, this is not our beginning. This is the Greek mythological account of how the world was created. So what's that all about? Today's lectionary reading selections included the passage from Genesis, the beginning. And as I meditated about what I could speak to you about this week on Pastor Harold's vacation day, I kept coming back to just how enthralled I am with the opening of the Bible. And so today I'm going to ask you to indulge me and let me just be super geeky about some things that I learned about the beginning of the Bible and share with you how they have transformed how I personally view the Bible. They have added to and centered my awe of the character of God that I call my God, and it has solidified my faith in a very powerful way. I also will ask you to keep in mind that I'm one day less of preparation. Normally, like, I would write out word for word everything I wanted to say to you and make sure that I'm phrasing it the best way possible, but doing it a whole day early, I have more of an outline than a word for word thing, so just, and here's the thing too, I don't need the words because God has them, and so it just, it's going to be all right. So cosmology is the word that we use to define, no, stay on that other slide, I'll tell you when to switch. Thank you. Mark is amazing, by the way. I love this guy. Cosmology is the word we use to define the origin and development of the universe, which is how we conceive how the world began. Why does it matter? Well, to some of us it might matter, and to some of us it won't. I would argue this, that the first time you read the beginning of Genesis, you learn a few very important things. One, that God is a creative, loving mind, and that you are created in his image. And if you get that from your first reading of Genesis, you've gotten the most important things out of the text. However, God designed the Bible to be meditation literature, and it's also ancient literature. And therefore, a full reading of the text, we need to consider all of the intentions of the author of the book, which in this case is God. sort of God. We are God's hands and feet. I know you've heard that before, but we are also God's voice. And God chose ancient people to be his voice. This does not mean, which is a common mythology some of us have, that God magically dropped word for word into their brains what the Bible was supposed to be. The Bible was crafted by many messengers over thousands of years. And each messenger, when they wrote down the words that God inspired them to say, have a time and a culture that impacts how they phrase things, impacts how they understand and communicate things. The Bible was written in another language. So every version of the Bible that you could possibly be reading, unless you're reading it in ancient Hebrew and Arabic, which I am not skilled enough to do, has already been translated by at least one human. And so you have to take that into account when you're deeply considering what the words mean. And I recognize that this can be frustrating and hard work that we really don't want to do when we read the Bible. But I will just encourage you to remember that God is the one who chose these ancient Hebrews to be his messengers and to be his voice. And so we have to honor that as part of how we are honoring God. A couple things about translating from one language to another. You can't just translate word for word. It just doesn't work for that. Take idioms for account. I'm an English teacher. This is a thing that I do. It's raining cats and dogs. There's no cats and dogs falling out of the sky. It's just raining really hard. But someone from another language who heard that might be confused about what we're talking about. It's probably more appropriate on a day like today to say, watch out for the snow drifts. The snow is not drifting anywhere. It's just in the road where your car wants to be. The dead of winter, nothing has died. This sermon is officially now on thin ice. It's just the tip of the iceberg. Do you see where I'm going with this? You can't just word for word translate and assume that you understand the meaning of what's there. And those are English idioms that when you translate them. Other languages all have their own. For instance, in Sweden, when you say there's no cow on the ice, it means don't worry about it, we got this. Because I guess a cow would break through the ice and that would be dangerous. If there's no cow, it's all okay. I'm assuming, right? In Japan, to wear a hat on your head means that you're smiling and being nice in order to like cajole or fool someone in a way that harms others. In Arabic, you're encouraged as an axiom to stretch your legs as far as your blanket extends, which means there's an end to the blanket. We all have limits and certain resources, and we have to recognize that and live according to our limits. And all these idioms make sense if you know the origin and you take the time to figure out why that phrase means what it means. Also, be aware that words can change meaning over time, depending on how they get used in popular culture. One of my favorite examples of this is the word Nimrod. When you hear it, you probably think of what its definition is, how we use today. Can I put you on the spot, Mark, and ask you what Nimrod means? No?
It's not a good thing.
It's not a good thing? It's a derogatory term that we use to say to someone who we consider stupid, right? The original meaning of Nimrod comes from the Bible. Nimrod was a biblical character. He was a great hunter, and the word means rebel. And it changed meaning. Here's what makes this one so fascinating. I love language. Bugs Bunny used to call Elmer Fudd Nimrod back in the Looney Tunes cartoons back in the day. And they were so popular that people who didn't know the biblical story of Nimrod the hunter just assumed Bugs Bunny calling Nimrod was calling Elmer Fudd an idiot because he was never able to catch Bugs Bunny. But Bugs Bunny was actually being sarcastic, like aren't you a great hunter, even though he's not. And so the meaning of the word has changed from being rebel into being someone that's stupid. In like language, it's amazing, right? So you can't just even like if you know what the word means, it's when it was originally used. And I'm gonna stop there, but I probably could go on for hours with all these kinds of examples about how fascinating language is, but Mark and Aaron want to go home before the storm starts, so we'll move on to the next topic. So today what I want to take the time to do is to discuss the biblical account of creation and how it compares with other ancient societies and to our own modern cosmology, and just talk about what we can pull away from the meaning of that. Next slide. In Egypt, so this is a picture that represents the Egyptian cosmology. Out of the waters is how they say it. An egg rises, we don't know why. It fertilizes itself and begins giving birth to gods. First, the sky god is formed, who then gives birth to the land god, and the sky god stretches herself above the land god to protect it from all the chaos that's always surrounding it and trying to overcome it. And, you know, more gods are birthed and whatever, and eventually we get to the point where it's the god Ra's job to every day travel from one end of the sky to the other, to go through the underworld, re-defeat chaos in order for the sun to be able to rise up the next day. And on any day, if Ra fails to do this, the sun won't rise and chaos will win. I know that sounds crazy, doesn't it? Next slide. The ancient Israelites wouldn't think any of that sounded crazy, because the ancient Egyptian account of the cosmos is frightfully similar to how they viewed the cosmos. So this is a picture of how ancient Israelites thought that the world was. When we hear the first words of the Bible, when God began to create the heavens of earth, if you're like me, you're imagining the globe of earth, right? Being like formed out of just blackness. But if we're the ancient Israelites and we're reading those words, I mean, the first most fundamental difference we have to acknowledge is that they thought the earth was flat. They didn't conceive of the earth as a globe as we do, so that wasn't written to be our earth, it's written to be their earth. The second verse goes, the earth was then weltered and waste in darkness over the deep. Robert Alter, when he chose the phrasing welter and waste, he chose it because the original words tovu von vovu rhyme in ancient Hebrew, and he felt that honored that sort of like poetic convention more. And the words welter and waste, tovu von vovu, they represent something being unordered and uninhabited, not the nothingness that I just had in my imagination a moment ago. So stuff was there, but it didn't have order to it, and it didn't have beings upon it. The meaning of the word creation has changed over time. What I used to think was that when God created the heavens and earth, just poof, it appeared out of nothing. But what the biblical authors mean when they say God created is that God chose to create by separating, naming, and ordering things. And as we go through parts of that opening passage again, listen to that's how they describe God doing those three actions, separating, naming, and ordering. And in fact, if we traveled back in time and tried to tell an ancient Egyptian that the earth was a globe, they wouldn't be able to process it right away, at least not without like reframing their description of the universe. So we're gonna travel back in time, we're gonna be responsible travelers, we're gonna honor the mindset of the people who God chose to write the text for us. On day one, God names light, and when he names it, he creates it. And then he orders the light by separating it from the darkness, right? And he gives light its own place and darkness its own place. He literally, when he does this, creates time, which didn't exist before then. And we're not even gonna touch that rabbit hole of how do you visualize what nothing is and how do you visualize timelessness, because that's a whole separate sermon all on its own. Day two, God calls for a vault in the middle of the waters, the vault in the midst of the waters to divide the water from the water. The water beneath the vault from the water above the vault, separating them. So if you look at the picture here, you'll see that there's a physical dome above the land in that picture. And so that's what God's doing, is he's creating a space within just a world of water. And you'll see that there's water above that physical dome, and there's water below that physical dome. This is how the ancient Israelites thought the world was designed. In fact, in Noah's flood, later in Genesis, it's described as God opening the windows of the vault. If you look at the picture really closely, you can see there's little windows there, and that's how God floods the earth and how it rains, as the windows get open to let the water that's above there come down. God names the vaults heaven, and he names the other stuff as part of his creation act. On day three, God says, let the waters under the heavens be gathered in one place, so that dry land will appear. So he's separating land from water. That's an act of creation. Fun fact, on day three, there's a bonus act of creation that makes day three double good. God calls it good in verses 10 and verse 12 because on day three, he creates land and separates it from the water, but then he also populates the land with plants and trees and such. So day three is double good. Day four, he begins filling the land and heaven with beings, so birds in the sky, fish in the sea. And these are all signs of ordering. Day four, he fills the vault of heaven, which is what's above that dome, with the stars and the sun and the moon, and then gives them the yearly cycle. You're going to change this many times, and the moon is going to rise and flow. Day five, he fills the heavens with birds and the waters with sea. In day six, he fills the land with animals and eventually humans, but we didn't get that far in the passage yet. So let's compare and contrast this vision of ancient Israel's cosmos with like the ancient Egyptian cosmos with, you know, the goddess literally being the sky. So here's some things that those cultures have in common. The images of the cosmos are frightfully similar. You see they both represent being surrounded by water. And I think the reason ancients thought that is because if you look up into the sky, it's blue. So that must be water up there, and you don't know what's holding it back if you don't have science to tell you otherwise, right? Israel's and the other ancients' creation narratives do contain acts of creations, where they define creation in the same way, and that's separating, naming, and ordering things. All of the narratives, when you study them, begin in that welter of waste where chaos yields to order. And in all of the ancient narratives, humans, or at least some of them, are become the images of the gods that created them. That's not the part that's mind-blowing, though. The part that's mind-blowing is when you look at the way the Israelite narrative, the version in our Bible, differs from the versions of the people who lived around them at that time. And those differences are where I meditate and where I learn to fall in love with the character of God over and over again. So here's where my mind gets blown. In Israel's narrative, God names all humans to be in his image. The other narratives say just some select humans that are supposedly born by gods are in the image of the gods, and that you should therefore submit to them in authority. And God says, no, you should submit your authority to God. You should honor authority because, you know, one of the things you do to be a good person is you follow the rules, but your rulers should also be submitting to God. Other ancient cosmos have that welter and race chaos that gives rise to God. And in that version, the chaos is there first. It pre-exists the creation of a God. In our account, God predates the chaos. And chaos isn't something that's dangerous to God like it's dangerous to other gods. Let's look at this version. So next slide. This is a version of the Babylonian god Marduk overcoming the chaos in order to fix creation. In this version, the world begins with fresh water and salt water all swirling together in chaos, and they eventually give birth to a bunch of gods who are ruining everything and it's not working. So Marduk rises above and battles Tiamat, which is the god of chaos and salt water, and puts things in order in the correct way. And because Marduk is the patron god of Babylonia, that's the justification, because he defeated all these other gods is why you should submit to the assimilation of the Babylonian Empire. But the thing is, chaos never fully dies, and so Marduk has to battle it over and over again, just like Ra in that Egyptian version on any given day could fail to overcome the snake of chaos and the sun won't rise the next day. But in the Israelite version, chaos is not a danger to God. It's just a thing. It's like a canvas with which he can create things out of. It's not dangerous, and I think that's beautiful. God does not create the world in an act of violence, like the other ancient narratives depict, because he doesn't need violence to create. He did it with love and with a word. Monotheism, the fact that there's just one God with a beautiful mind that created everything, is what made the Israelite religion then and now just so completely revolutionary, and along with it, the idea that all human life is valuable, that is revolutionary and world-changing, then and now. And then and now, right, even the ancient Israelites struggled with maintaining that belief in the face of overwhelming opposition and self-interest, because it's easy to think of yourself as being more important than other people than it is to remember that we are all created in the image of God and live according to that. Other cosmologies are there designed as a means of holding power over other people and justify your position in society. Israel's cosmos is a challenge that, I don't know, sometimes feels impossible to achieve, where it asks us to rise to the challenge to feel compassionate and love for everyone that we are surrounded with. And I like that better. Even if I haven't gotten there yet. Even if I never get there, I want to spend my life trying. Two slides ahead. So what is our cosmos? Because we do have a version of it. Many of you will say, right, who don't have a biblical background, is that it all began with a big bang and then grew slowly over time through evolution and random chance. Even if we don't believe in those things, I think we can all agree that we live on a planet. It's the third rock from the sun, as the saying goes. And it revolves around the sun, not the other way around. And the sun is actually a star, and that star is part of the galaxy. And that galaxy, the Milky Way, there's like lots of other galaxies out there in the stars, and it's all layers upon layers. In fact, this is so well known that if Jackie was here today, I could probably call her down, give her the microphone, because she loves talking in the microphone, and she could explain this all to you. So how is that cosmos, the cosmos of how science created the world, similar to and different from, you can go to the next slide, the Israelite cosmos? Well, one, there are some similarities, right? Let's do the analysis in the same way. The nothing that we imagine that precedes the Big Bang is the modern version of the welter and waste that's in the Bible. In both accounts, there's a process whereby creation builds in complexity, and in both, there's a single point that begins it all. But the difference is where the awe is. In the biblical account of the creation, creation is not random. It is purposeful. The scientific cosmos model is focused on the mechanism of how did it happen? Let's quantify it. The biblical version recounts the purpose of creation. Why are we here? And what should we be doing with ourselves? And I think it's important to acknowledge that those two accounts are not telling the same story, because our view of the universe has changed so much since then. So it's okay for them both to exist in our brain, and they don't have to cancel each other out, because why we're telling that narrative has a different purpose. So the culture wars don't matter. When we stay focused on the purpose of God's creation, why we're here, as God expressed to us in the beginning, words of the Bible, who through the messengers he chose to write them down, how many days in real life is a God day in the 7-day narrative, doesn't matter. Is evolution real or not? It doesn't matter, because that's not what the Bible is trying to tell us. The Bible is telling us the purpose for God's creation and what we're supposed to be doing as part of it. If the news came out tomorrow and said evolution was definitely proved wrong, nothing that I said here today would change. And the opposite of that is true. If, you know, a news story came out tomorrow and like, we've definitely proved evolution right, everything I said here today would still be true. And that's awe-inspiring to me. There's a lot more to dig in here, centered around just this first book of the Bible. I mean, honestly, there's a lot we haven't touched. I didn't even finish reading yet. We haven't talked about the creation of man, how God delegates his authority. When you go back to that picture, what is Sheol? Why is the earth on top of pillars? There's so much more there. But if I went over all that, my sermon would be too long. It would be out of place. It would be chaotic and not ordered, and it would not make sense. See what I did there? I actually had 8 pages of notes and 3 hours of podcasts that I managed to condense into a talk about just one thing, and I'm okay with that. But I will leave you with this as the where we go next, this reminder. The Bible is meditation literature. So meditate. Choose a passage of the Bible that you already love and dig into it and see what more there is to know. Let your mind be blown by our creative, compassionate, faithful God that chose us to be his image. Please join us in our closing hymn. Have changed over time. There's value in taking awe to marvel at that creation. In fact, today is a great day. Look out, the snow falling, and appreciate this part of the creation for us to marvel at. And then marvel some more at the God who imagined it all. Have a great week, everyone.